Welcome to Practice Exercises for the TOEFL 6th Edition. Exercise 27. Talk 1. Listen to part of a discussion in an education class.
I'm sorry. I just don't agree with you at all.
Look, take the example of an international student applying for university admission. If the student has a 250 on the TOEFL or an 80 on the Michigan test, most admissions officers will accept the applicant. The student with a 247 or 79 won't be considered. The officer won't even look at transcripts.
Right, but I think that proves my point, not yours.
How?
Well, it's the admissions officer who decides how to use the test. The TOEFL and the Michigan are good English proficiency tests. But that's all they are. And English proficiency is necessary for success in an American university. But so are several other factors, including good academic preparation.
Good academic preparation is more important.
Maybe. I don't really know. But what I'm trying to explain to you is that admissions officers should use the proficiency test as one of many considerations. And as such, they really shouldn't insist on a rigid cutoff score like 250 or 80.
Isn't this the basic disagreement? That Paul thinks the tests are bad in themselves, and Sally believes that the tests are good, but that many people don't use them for their intended purpose.
I don't agree with having the tests, Professor Ayers, and that's my position.
But Paul, what would you do to evaluate the English proficiency of a student 10,000 miles away without a standardized test?
I admit, that's a big problem.
It sure is.
Okay, class. For Wednesday, let's consider the problem of evaluation without standardized tests like the TOEFL, the SAT, GMAT, and GRE. Paul says that there ought to be an alternative. Sally doesn't seem to believe that there is an appropriate alternative. Please bring in your ideas and suggestions, and we'll discuss them.
Number one, what do the speakers mainly discuss? Two, what is Paul's opinion about the TOEFL and the Michigan test? Three, what does Sally say about the admissions officers? Four, how does the professor handle the disagreement? Five, where did this discussion most probably take place? Talk two. Listen to part of a discussion in a linguistics class.
Since so many of you have asked me about how to learn a language, I thought it might be useful to take some class time today to discuss it. Betty, you speak several languages, don't you?
Yes, I speak Spanish and French.
And what helped you most in learning those languages?
What helped me most? Well, I studied both languages in high school, and I'm still studying Spanish here at the university. But I think that travel has probably been the most help to me. You see, I've been lucky in that I've lived in Europe. And believe me, I didn't speak very well before I moved there.
You're right, Betty. After studying a language, practice is very useful. When you live in a country where the language is spoken, it's ideal. But you know, sometimes it's difficult to make friends in a new place, even when the people are very friendly.
Yes, I know what you mean, especially if you don't speak the language too well. I had some problems when I first moved to Europe.
And, of course, some people are shy.
That's true.
Professor Baker, whether or not I'm living in a country where the language is spoken, I always go to movies, and whenever I can, I watch TV or listen to the radio in the language I'm trying to learn.
Me too. And reading is another good way to learn. Books are good, but I think that newspapers and magazines are even better.
Probably the best way to learn is to combine all of these ideas. Traveling, talking with people, going to movies, watching TV, listening to the radio, and reading books, newspapers, and magazines. What do you think?
I agree with that, Professor Baker.
So do I, but I don't believe that it's possible to take advantage of practice opportunities without some knowledge of the language first.
Sure. First, it's a good idea to study grammar, vocabulary,
and listening, perhaps even reading.
Then practice is very, very helpful.
Number one, what do the speakers mainly discuss? Two, why does Professor Baker begin the discussion by calling on Betty? Three, what helped Betty most in learning Spanish? Four, what is Professor Baker's opinion? Five, how can we best describe Professor Baker? Exercise 28, Talk 1. Listen to part of a seminar in an art class.
Let me remind you that this is a seminar, so I won't be lecturing. This is a discussion format, and that means that I expect you to respond to the reading assignments. No need to raise your hand. Just be moderately courteous about taking turns. Remember that 30% of your grade is based on class participation, okay? Now, with that in mind, let's begin our discussion of Chapter 22 in the main textbook. What is pop art?
I'll start. Pop art, as I understand it, was a movement that began in the early 60s when painters, I think it was mostly painters, began to use commercial objects like bottles, comic strips, cigarette packages, and like that as subjects for their art.
Okay, so I'll ask the obvious question. Why paint these objects when they're everywhere?
Well, first, let me mention that although there were several artists who were associated with the pop movement, it's probably Andy Warhol whose paintings best represent it. And I believe Warhol had a response for that question. I think he said, "Everything is art. Everything is beautiful."
Yes, he did say that. I'm glad you mentioned it. So let's focus on Warhol for a few minutes. There are some examples of his work on page 524 of your textbook. As you see, he painted enormous Campbell's soup cans, lines of Coca-Cola bottles, and rows of Martinson coffee cans. Any ideas about these particular subjects?
Well, of course, the story is that Warhol actually ate soup for lunch every day for 20 years, so when he decided to paint objects in the environment, then the soup can naturally came to mind. Do you think that's true, Dr. Stevens?
Tom, it certainly is a widespread myth, but probably closer to reality is the fact that Warhol was once a commercial artist and that it was a logical transition for him personally to paint products. He went from commercial ads to art, that gave expression to the same kinds of objects. But he painted people, too. Any thoughts on that?
Well, he painted faces, actually. Huge images of the popular, the celebrities of the 60s. There were several of Marilyn Monroe and Elvis Presley.
And at least one of Jacqueline Kennedy. But I was thinking that they really weren't portraits in the strictest sense.
That's interesting. What do you mean?
I'm not sure, but besides the giant canvases, well, the way that they were presented, it also had a commercial feel. I don't know. I'm not saying that too well.
No, I think you're onto something. Do you mean perhaps that the people are commercialized in a sense, like a brand name?
Exactly. I think the book identified the subjects in the Face series as popular icons. That was it, of the 60s. So maybe their faces do have commercial appeal.
Yes, and he wasn't always very flattering, was he?
No, he wasn't. What do you think about the colors?
That's what I mean. Sometimes the colors are almost psychedelic. Again, that's very retro. Very 60s.
Let's go back to one of the Marilyn Monroe paintings in your book. Let me see. Here it is. Turn to page 526. You can't see it very well here, but on the original, the paint actually gives the impression of colored ink. And there's usually often a black stencil over it, which produces a unique effect. See how the orange background contrasts with the yellow hair, and there's a pink and a purple tone on the face? Then there's this green eyeshadow, and to me, it looks like he stenciled the black over the flat surfaces of the face. It's not a lovely portrait. And the critics agreed with you, Julia. Some critics even called it grotesque. But it is absolutely original.
Original, but dated, don't you think? I mean, years from now, will anyone be eating Campbell's soup or drinking Coca-Cola? Or really, for that matter, will anyone remember Marilyn Monroe?
Interesting observation. So, Tom, you're saying that since pop art, since it depends on the popular culture, which by its very nature is transient, you're asking, will the subject matter of the pop art movement doom its artists to temporary recognition?
Exactly, which I'm thinking is really different from, well, unlike a painter who chooses to create landscapes, which don't change.
Number one. What is this session mainly about? Two. According to the lecturer, why did Warhol paint objects in the environment? Three. Whose faces did Warhol paint? Four. What problem does Tom mention? Five. Listen again to part of the talk. Then answer the question.
I mean, years from now, will anyone be eating Campbell's soup or drinking Coca-Cola? Or really, for that matter, will anyone remember Marilyn Monroe?
Interesting observation. So, Tom, you're saying that since pop art, since it depends on the popular culture, which by its very nature is transient, you're asking, will the subject matter of the pop art movement doom its artists to temporary recognition?
Why does the professor say this?
So, Tom, you're saying that since pop art, since it depends on the popular culture, which by its very nature is transient, you're asking, will the subject matter of the pop art movement doom its artists to temporary recognition?
Six. Select a drawing that is done in the Andy Warhol style. Talk two. Listen to part of a lecture in an environmental science class. The professor is discussing the web of life.
To review from yesterday's lecture, ecology is the study of organisms in relation to their environment. The total complex of relationships is referred to as the web of life. Now, you'll remember that when the relationships don't change much from year to year, when they don't change, we observe a balance of nature. Today, we'll discuss what occurs when the balance of nature is disturbed, either by a geological change, such as a change of climate, or a local agitation, such as a fire, like the recent forest fire north of here. Now, after the balance of nature has been disturbed, when it's disturbed, a period of rehabilitation must occur, and the first life to appear has traditionally been called pioneer flora and fauna. But the pioneer life is temporary and soon replaced by other forms of life. In turn, these forms are replaced by others. That is, a series of transitional life forms successively appears, preparing the environment for the forms that will replace them.
Excuse me, Dr. Green. Would that be what the book refers to as ecological succession?
It is. For example, after a forest fire, pioneer plants will appear, and they are usually herbs or ground cover. Now, soon, they'll be replaced by shrubs. Shrubs will be replaced by trees, and so it goes in succession, which is where we get the term ecological succession. Now, until very recently, it was assumed that plants and animals would form a climax community, and that's a final stage in the ecological succession, and that tended to be stable for a long time. So, in the case of the forest fire, when a permanent climax flora appeared, we would have assumed that the environment had finally stabilized in balance with the fauna, minerals, and water supply. And the theory was interesting because a climax community, because it usually didn't have the same kinds of plants and animals as the community that had been prevalent before the balance of nature was disturbed. Now, what was essential to the concept of a climax was that the balance of nature permitted the community to continue in spite of other organic competition for the area. But the notion of a stable, symbiotically functioning community has been mostly abandoned by scientists. Currently, we believe that natural ecosystems are much too complex to be neatly organized into predictable stages with a final stable community. So what we can expect in the case of the fire is the emergence of patches of former landscapes, and these patches will be at different stages in the same local environment. Question.
So the patches are in different stages, and that would be a polyclimax condition?
That's exactly right, Mike. Poly means many, so polyclimax refers to adjoining ecosystems at different but mature stages. I believe it's explained as dynamic equilibrium in your text.
Thank you. That's very helpful.
Janet?
Yes. I was wondering what your opinion was of that wildfire. You know, the one near here? In the book, it was mentioned that sometimes that fire is now recognized... How did they say it? Fire is a natural part of an ecosystem, and at least some experts have been quoted in news reports that they feel fire prevention strategies may have contributed to that disaster. So, do you agree with that?
I do. That particular ecosystem had an enormous amount of undergrowth, and I think that it may have fueled the fire. Now, in my opinion, if we had purposely burned some of the undergrowth in what we call a cool fire, we would have removed the accumulation of brush that contributed to the destructive hot fire that destroyed more than, I think I read that it was 50,000 acres of wilderness. Yes?
Is a cool fire a controlled burn?
Yes, it's referred to as a controlled burn. But back to your original question. I have to tell you that everyone wouldn't agree with my opinion. Critics call that policy the let-it-burn policy. Now, of course, many people have a vested interest in fire suppression, Because so many people have built their homes close to the natural environments, they don't want any fires started in their immediate vicinity. So, like your textbook indicates, it's a very controversial topic.
Number one, what is the main topic of today's lecture? Two, how does the scientific community view the theory of a stable climax community? Three. According to the lecturer, why is pioneer life important? Four. What is Dr. Green's opinion of a controlled burn? Five. Listen again to part of the talk, then answer the question.
That is, a series of transitional life forms successively appears, preparing the environment for the forms that will replace them.
Excuse me, Dr. Green, would that be what the book refers to as ecological succession?
Why did the student ask this question?
Would that be what the book refers to as ecological succession?
Six. The professor describes the process of ecological succession that occurs after the balance of nature has been disturbed. Summarize the process by putting the events in order.